The Bible is true and historically accurate. Dating methods in archaeology are wrought with fraud and false assumptions. One of our faulty assumptions has been that only one pharaoh was involved throughout the lifetime of a particular biblical Hebrew. But just as the prophet Daniel lived through the reigns of several kings in Babylon, Joseph and Moses lived through the reigns of several pharaohs of Egypt. Before we get to the pharaohs, we'll look at the biblical timeline and the lineage of truth given to Abram, and the prophecy of the Exodus that was given to Abram. Passover begins with a prayer acknowledging Creator God as King of the universe, and we can trace how that knowledge was handed down from Adam. In the 1600s, Archbishop Usher of Ireland compiled an amazing timeline of world history, starting at the release of King Jehoiakim from Babylon's prison when Nebuchadnezzar died in 562 BC, and using Israel's reignal lengths and all the begats in the Bible, working backwards and arriving at Adam's creation in 4004 BC. Before the flood, most men lived for 900 years. Adam lived long enough to transfer his knowledge of creation to Lamech, who passed it on to Noah and his sons. The lineage of truth continued through Shem, from whom we get the term Semitic, and through Eber, for whom the language Hebrew is named. Shem lived to be 600 years old and passed truth of God's creation to Abram. Isaac taught truth to Jacob, whom God renamed Israel, so it was the children of Israel whom God delivered out of Egypt. They were called Israelites in Egypt before they conquered the Promised Land. And he said to him, I am the Lord that brought you out of Ur of the Chaldees to give you this land to inherit it. And he said to Abram, Know of a surety that your seed shall be a stranger in a land that is not theirs, and shall serve them, and they shall afflict them 400 years. And also that nation whom they shall serve will I judge, and afterward shall they come out with great substance. Genesis 15. The underlined portion is God's prophecy concerning the Exodus. God first promised to give the land of Canaan to Abram and his descendants when Abram was 75 years old in Genesis 12. The Genesis 15 prophecy occurs after Abram's victorious rescue of Lot when Abram was 83 years old. But Abram's descendants won't return to Egypt for 200 years. Joseph will be sold to Potiphar as a slave at the age of 17, but at the age of 30, Pharaoh will place him in charge of Egypt and give him a wife and a signet ring. These signet rings were in the shape of a scarab beetle with a rounded back and a flat bottom with a hole through them for twine to secure them to the finger or to wear them as a necklace. The flat side was engraved with a design and the owner's name. Seal impressions were especially important in grain and food shipments. On September 22, 2009, an article appeared in the Egyptian Daily about Biblical-era coins found, but they weren't coins, they were scarab seals, as the picture shows. This led to cries of fraud, but the article goes on, the researcher identified coins from many different periods, including coins that bore special markings identifying them as being from the era of Joseph. Among these, there was one coin that had an inscription on it, and an image of a cow symbolizing Pharaoh's dream about the 7 fat cows and 7 lean cows, and the 7 green stalks of grain and the 7 dry stalks of grain. It was found that the inscriptions of this early period were usually simple, since writing was still in its early stages, and consequently there was difficulty in deciphering the writing on these coins. But the research team managed to translate the writing on the coin by comparing it to the earliest known hieroglyphic texts. Joseph's name appears twice on this coin written in hieroglyphs, once the original name Joseph and once his Egyptian name, Saba Sabani, which was given to him by Pharaoh when he became treasurer. There is also an image of Joseph, who was part of the Egyptian administration at that time. Har means mountain and could refer to Mount Moriah, where Jacob's father was spared when God provided a ram. One scarab seal of Jacob Har was found in Shikmona, Canaan, about the time of the 15th dynasty, but with the complete absence of any other royal name scarabs below or contemporary to it. Shikmona is near Haifa, Israel, and the coast. It could be that Jacob knew people there and opened trade with them, whereas earlier 14th and 15th dynasty rulers had no such connections. Almost the first of the 18th dynasty conquered the 15th dynasty in the Nile Delta and built huge temporary silos over their citadel in Avaris. Archaeologist Manfred Biatok explained, "In the northern section of our excavations, the platform C of the late Hyksos period had been taken down and a storage compound was set on top of it. It consisted of at least 30 round grain silos and probably more. Each silo was about 5.25 meters or 10 cubits in diameter. The construction was flimsy and looks as if it was meant to be short-lived. This amenity was used to store enormous quantities of grain, more than 5,000 cubic meters, and probably other foodstuff for a considerable number of people." The close stylistic similarity between the scarabs of Cayenne and Jacob Har was noted by Ward in Tufnell's 1984 book. Cayenne was the second to the last pharaoh of the 15th dynasty. The triple scroll borders were also common in 12th, 13th, and especially the 14th dynasty scarabs of Sheshi, and they may represent continuity of the Nile Delta. I propose that Joseph placed his father Jacob in charge of the huge import-export business at Avaris. Of Jacob Har's 35 recovered scarab seals, 9 were found in Avaris by Manfred Biatok. One of Jacob Har's seal impressions was found in Kerma, Nubia. So we've ascertained that Joseph and Jacob served under Amos the First, but under what pharaoh would the Israelites leave Egypt? The 400 years is linked to Abram's seed, who would be put down by his half-Egyptian half-brother Ishmael. The 430 years are linked to God's first promise to Abram when he was 75 years old. The law was given 50 days from the beginning of the Exodus, the 50 days of the counting of the Omer. Isaac was born 25 years after God's promise to Abram, plus 5 years for weaning equals the 30 years. Taking another look at God's prophecy about the Exodus, it shows Abram's descendants would return to Canaan after the fourth generation. It is interesting that Joseph was the fourth generation from Abram. Joseph's sons Manasseh and Ephraim were born during the 7 years of plenty between 715 and 1707. Genesis 50:23, "And Joseph saw Ephraim's children of the third generation, and children also of Machir, the son of Manasseh, were brought up on Joseph's knees." But a 26-year average is a fairly short biblical generation. According to Numbers 32:13, an adult generation was 40 years. That would start the fourth generation about 1546 BC, and Moses was born in 1571 BC and delivered that fourth generation from bondage. Why were sheep and shepherds an abomination to Egyptians? "And Moses said, It is not meet so to do, for we shall sacrifice the abomination of the Egyptians to the Lord our God. See, shall we sacrifice the abomination of the Egyptians before their eyes, and will they not stone us?" Since the sacrifice of sheep and lambs is the focus of the Passover, we need to understand why that was an abomination to Egyptians. During the Second Intermediate Period, the Nile Delta was ruled by Asiatic shepherds and traders known as Hyksos of the 15th dynasty. The Egyptian word for foreign chiefs or rulers is Hyksos. A latter king of this dynasty, Apepi, also called Apophis, began to plunder and sell the monuments of Memphis. About the time of Joseph's birth, Theban pharaoh Tau II began skirmishing with King Apepi of the Hyksos, and you can see by all the axe wounds that he was killed in battle. Tau's oldest son, Khamos, continued to fight the Hyksos, even winning a battle against their capital at Avaris, but he was also killed after reigning 4 years. This left his little brother Amos. Amos the First lost his father and brother in battles against the Hyksos, and he began his reign at the age of 10 with his mother guiding him. He must have hated the Hyksos shepherds for killing his father and brother and dividing and selling Egypt. 11 years later, he took up the war against the Hyksos and eventually drove them out and reconquered Canaan as well. Amos brought back herds of cattle from Bashan. The Hyksos capital, Avaris, has been confirmed at what's now called Tel Eldaba and Esbit Rushdi. Saqqara was where Joseph worked at Djoser's food complex and step pyramid during the 7 years of plenty and famine. Heliopolis was ancient On. Joseph's father-in-law was high priest of On, an office Joseph assumed when his father-in-law died. On was the capital of the Egyptian nome or district of Geshen, which meant grass and pasturage. It was also called the land of Ramses, because Ramsosh meant shepherds in the Egyptian language. So now you know why the Egyptians hated shepherds. 15th dynasty shepherds ruled the Nile Delta about 100 years before Amos from Thebes conquered them in the Delta and at Sheruhan, south of Gaza. Prior to the war with the Hyksos, Amos had a son named Amenhotep I. During the years of plenty, Amos died, and young Amenhotep began his reign under his mother, Amos Nefertari, as regent. Thus the governmental responsibilities to prepare the land for the remaining plentiful years and the 7 years of famine were truly directed by Joseph. Amos Nefertari used the time to train Amenhotep to govern, and her bitterness against the Hyksos shepherds was also duly transferred. Jacob's family moved to Egypt during the second year of the famine, which was 1706 BC. So Amenhotep I is likely a teenager when he meets them and asks Jacob how old he is. And Joseph said to his brothers and to his father's house, I will go up and show Pharaoh and say to him, My brothers and my father's house, which were in the land of Canaan, are come to me, and the men are shepherds, for their trade has been to feed cattle, and they have brought their flocks and their herds, and all that they have. And it shall come to pass, when Pharaoh shall call you, and shall say, What is your occupation? That you shall say, Your servant's trade has been about cattle from our youth even until now, both we and also our fathers, that you may dwell in the land of Goshen, for every shepherd is an abomination to the Egyptians. And he took some of his brothers, even 5 men, and presented them to Pharaoh. And Pharaoh said to his brothers, What is your occupation? And they said to Pharaoh, Your servants are shepherds, both we and also our fathers. They said moreover to Pharaoh, For to sojourn in the land are we come, for your servants have no pasture for their flocks, for the famine is sore in the land of Canaan. Now therefore we pray you, let your servants dwell in the land of Goshen. Genesis 47. But young Amenhotep thought that since they were from Canaan, they could handle the cattle from Bashan, so he made them his cattle czars. Genesis 47. And Joseph gathered up all the money that was found in the land of Egypt and in the land of Canaan, for the corn which they bought, and Joseph brought the money into Pharaoh's house. So the land became Pharaoh's, and you shall give the fifth part to Pharaoh. During the famine, all Egyptians became Pharaoh's slaves. Thereafter, they were to give Pharaoh a fifth of all they produced. Genesis 50. And Joseph said to his brothers, I die, and God will surely visit you, and bring you out of this land to the land which he swore to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. And Joseph took an oath of the children of Israel, saying, God will surely visit you, and you shall carry up my bones from hence. So Joseph died, being 110 years old, and they embalmed him, and he was put in a coffin in Egypt. Joseph's descendants carried his bones and built a tomb for them in Shechem, which is now Nablus and under Palestinian jurisdiction. In over 150 years, you can imagine that the Hebrew population spread throughout the Egyptian Empire, though a large population would remain in Goshen. Eventually, a pharaoh came to rule who knew not Joseph, Amenhotep III. The Hittite kingdom was a continual threat. If the Hebrews allied with them against Egypt, it would be a disaster. This new king, Amenhotep III, is aware of a large foreign population in his kingdom whose loyalties could turn against him, and so he subjugates them and uses them to build treasure cities in the Nile Delta, in and near Goshen. The children of Israel did not build the pyramids. Those were completed hundreds of years prior to their enslavement. But Israelites lived throughout Egypt by this time, so I think others were enslaved to complete other building projects. First, Amenhotep III ordered the Hebrew midwives in the Delta to do his dirty work covertly, but they didn't. Amenhotep then put Hebrews to work building his brick palaces and commanded their Egyptian neighbors to kill the Hebrew baby boys, but he eventually had to send in soldiers to kill the Hebrew babies. As for Amenhotep III, he had at least 6 children, 2 sons and 4 daughters. His queen was named Tai. Queen Tai's father was rich and lived in Akhmim. In Amenhotep's 11th year, he built a palace in Jakaro, near Akhmim, and a palace called Malkata, west of Thebes, both of which connected to the Nile and had artificial lakes. Malkata was called the Palace of the Dazzling Aten. It was Amenhotep III who first promoted the worship of Aten. I suggest Moses' family was working on the Akhmim palace of Queen Tai. Jochebed placed baby Moses in an ark and sent him downstream, which is north on the Nile. Moses was born on the 7th of Adar in 1571. This was in May, before the flooding of the Nile in June. 3 of 4 daughters are represented on Cairo's colossal statue of the family of Amenhotep III. Hanutteneb in the center, Nebeta on the right, is not pictured, and one whose name was destroyed on the left was likely Sidiman, the eldest. Miriam arranged for her brother to be nursed by their own mother at home. As noted with Ishmael, babies were nursed until about age 5, so Moses was raised in the safety of his parents' home during those formative years and instilled with their faith and values. Though Sidiman was groomed to rule, she was passed over for a much weaker brother, possibly because she had rescued Moses in defiance of her father's orders. Sidiman later married her father in his 30th year. So was it really Queen Tai protecting and raising Moses far away from her husband? In the Delta at the lion's lair given to her when they were married, Queen Tai's name was found in a royal cartouche there. Was she officiating the Delta of Lower Egypt while her husband officiated Upper Egypt in Thebes? I suggest Sidiman rescued baby Moses in Akhmim, and after he was weaned, they moved to the mansion of the lion in the Delta. Queen Tai likely oversaw international trade from the Mediterranean Sea. There were also canals connecting Tel El Borg to Ramses. Moses may have even gone on the boats to the treasure cities of Pithom and Ramses. Moses reached the age of 20 when Amenhotep III made his son Amenhotep IV his successor the year before he died. Queen Tai survived her husband by 12 years and continued in her foreign correspondence with kings as she oversaw Egypt's import-export business. The king of Mitanni sent one of his daughters to wed Amenhotep III, who became a wife to Amenhotep IV upon his father's death. Though gold might have been as prevalent as dust in the past, and gold pieces were found at Tel El Borg, Amenhotep IV decided not to part with the solid gold statues of the bride price his father neglected to send to the king of Mitanni, which bordered with the Hittites. Amenhotep IV built pylons and a temple to Aten in Karnak. Instead of military campaigns, he sought treaties, many of which are written upon clay tablets in cuneiform in the Akkadian language and called the Amarna letters. In his 4th year, he changed his name to Akhenaten, and the next year he used the Hebrew slaves to build his new city of Akhenaten, later called Amarna, with sandstone talatat blocks. Maybe Moses visited Akhenaten. Many believe Moses influenced Akhenaten's beliefs in monotheism of one creator god. In the 9th year of his reign, Akhenaten declared the sun disk, Aten, to now be the creator god, supreme to all others. The sun merely represented him. Akhenaten declared himself as Aten's only prophet and intermediary, conveniently undermining the authority of all other gods and their priests. He confiscated their lands and had Amun and plural names of God erased. Amenhotep III had a palace of the dazzling Aten, but his many statues were not desecrated. He may not have known about young Prince Moses being raised in the north. The reigns of Smenkher and Nefertiti were almost completely obliterated, covered up by Tutankhamun usurping their reignal years. After Akhenaten embraced monotheism, horrible diseases came upon the people, and they cried out to return to the old gods. Finally, Vizier I convinced young Tut to return to the old gods. Take a moment to rid your mind of assumptions based upon the movies you've seen portraying Moses. Whether the movies were black and white or full-color animations, they were not fully compatible with the Holy Bible. At the age of 40, Moses killed an Egyptian for beating a Hebrew, and he fled to Midian. Moses married and lived there for 39 years as a shepherd before God commanded him to return to Egypt. And the Lord said to Moses in Midian, "Go, return into Egypt, for all the men are dead which sought your life." Exodus 4:19. There were others in Akhenaten's palace who sought to be Pharaoh and might have seen Moses in the way, or they may have wanted to kill him for murdering the Egyptian taskmaster. When Tutankhaten became Pharaoh, Horemheb was commander of his army, and I was his vizier. Both I and Horemheb helped the young pharaoh get rid of the monistic Aten worship and try to salvage the deterioration it caused in the country. First, they changed his name to Tutankhamun, and Horemheb specifically worked to reestablish worship of all the old gods. Tutankhamun designated Horemheb as his crown prince, but Vizier I managed to succeed Tutankhamun instead. They continued the harsh oppression of the Hebrews in Goshen, as relations with the Mitanni and the Hittites were tenuous at best. Also, sea peoples from Europe were gaining a stronghold in Libya. Nefertiti was often pictured alone and in authority, like smiting the enemies. Akhenaten and Nefertiti's oldest daughter was named Meritaten, who likely married Smenkher. Based on this outline, the Hebrews were only under severe bondage for 90 years or so. Horemheb had no male heirs, so he made an administrator with sons and grandsons his heir. His name was Ramesses. Manfred Biatak has been excavating Avaris most of his adult life. Underneath a small pyramid tomb in the palace garden were the remains of a twice-life-size statue of an Asiatic pharaoh, skin painted yellow with red mushroom-shaped hair. He has the throw stick of a pharaoh over his right shoulder. The statue was intentionally demolished and defaced. I think this ruler came from a line of Byblos dignitaries of the pre-15th dynasty listed in the Turin Kings List, which orchestrated international trade in the Delta during the Second Intermediate Period and ended during the Second Biblical Famine. I propose that Seth II stepped in and saved the people from that Second Biblical Famine during Isaac's life, and they built him this memorial. I think Ramesses I named his son Seti after this Seth II, since Seti also had red hair. The 18th dynasty erected a temple to Seth in Avaris. Ramesses I of the 19th dynasty established a namesake capital, now called Kantir, a stone's throw from the old Hyksos capital of Avaris. Originally named Paramasu, Ramesses came from a strong military family. He likely married a red-headed European from Libya or Byblos to keep peace, because both Seti and Ramesses had red hair and associated themselves with the god Seth, also called Sutek, who had red hair. I don't think Seti was his firstborn son. Ramesses I's wife was named Tia. When Tia became queen, she changed her name to Sitra. The reign of Ramesses I lasted about 2 years, but it was quite an adventure. Exodus 4. And the Lord said to Moses in Midian, "Go, return into Egypt, for all the men are dead which sought your life." And Moses took his wife and his sons, and set them on an ass, and he returned to the land of Egypt. And Moses took the rod of God in his hand. And the Lord said to Moses, When you go to return into Egypt, see that you do all those wonders before Pharaoh, which I have put in your hand. But I will harden his heart, that he shall not let the people go. And you shall say to Pharaoh, Thus said the Lord, Israel is my son, even my firstborn. And I say to you, Let my son go, that he may serve me. And if you refuse to let him go, behold, I will slay your son, even your firstborn. I know there have been TV specials denouncing the miracles of the 10 plagues, which have said that the Egyptian firstborn slept on the first floor and were asphyxiated by gas, but that doesn't account for the selectivity of the firstborn beasts dying, nor of the firstborn Hebrews, which didn't apply the lamb's blood to their homes. The firstborn of Ramesses I would have been an adult male. Seti was likely secondborn. Heka was the god of magic and miracles, sometimes represented by two intertwined snakes. Egyptians had several gods of the Nile. Nun was the snake god, Khnum was the guardian of the Nile, and supposed to have created man from its mud. Sobek was a creator god with the body of a man and the head of a crocodile whose job was to protect the pharaoh. Taaret was the hippopotamus goddess. Amut was depicted with the head of a crocodile and the rear of a hippo. The Nile was considered the bloodstream of Osiris, the god of death in the underworld, so it was fitting for it to be turned to a river of blood. Heket was the wife of the creator of the world and the goddess of birth. Heket was always shown with the head and body of a frog. Hapi was the god of the Nile who was fed by crocodiles and frogs. Though the magicians could also produce frogs, they could not remove them. Geb was god of the land of Egypt, so the lice made him look bad. The magicians could not produce lice and finally feared the real god. Ati was the goddess of chaos and evil with the head of a wasp and the body of a hippopotamus. The stinging swarms were unleashed upon the Egyptians only, with God making a distinction between them and the Hebrews. The god Apis was represented as a bull, and the Apis bull was the living image of the god Ptah. Ptah was a creator god who spoke things into existence. There were also Bukis bulls and calves which were worshipped. Hathor was the goddess of the desert and its mines. She was depicted as a cow or a woman with cow's ears. Nut and Horus were sky gods, and Isis and Seth were supposed to protect crops. The mother-daughter goddess team of Emutet and Nepri guarded the grain. The fiery hail killed man and beast, which remained outside and destroyed the flax and barley. The locusts came and ate all the greenery that was left. Even more miraculous was that when Moses prayed for God to remove them, not one locust was left within Egypt's boundaries. Then Jehovah struck at Egypt's most revered gods of the sun, Ra, Aten, and Atum, the moon, Ah, Khons, and Isis, and stars, Thoth, Nut, and Seshat, by surrounding the Egyptians for 3 days with a tangible darkness which even snuffed out attempts to make fire. God led them not through the way of the land of the Philistines, although that was near, for God said, Lest peradventure the people repent when they see war and they return to Egypt. But God led the people about through the way of the wilderness of the Red Sea, and the children of Israel went up, harnessed out of the land of Egypt, and Moses took the bones of Joseph with him. Ramesses I took all the chariots of Egypt and pursued the Hebrews to the Gulf of Aqaba, where God drowned Pharaoh and the Egyptian army. Then his son Seti became Pharaoh and went after the Hebrews. God avoided taking the Hebrews along the road which would have placed them under immediate attack. In his first year, Seti attacked the Shashu, or Arabs, from Pithom to Canaan. An inscription reads, He attacked the hostile Shashu who inhabit the town of Pithom, even to the land of Canaanah. Seti knew the Hebrew slaves came from Canaan, but they weren't there when he arrived. He couldn't find them. He went to the Jordan River and sent divisions north and south. I think word arrived that corpses and war debris were washing up on the shores of the Gulf of Aqaba. So he may have assumed that whatever tidal wave wiped out the Egyptian army swept the Hebrews out to sea. Thus the Hebrews were safe and Canaan was prepared for their coming. But Seti needed a way of transporting the valuable war chariots back to Egypt. The canal was first dug during an ancient dynasty and stopped up and reopened several times. A letter dated to the 19th dynasty in the British Museum states, "Peasants were carried off by force to work the canals." I conjecture peasants had to be used because the Hebrew slaves were gone, and Seti wanted an easier way to retrieve the damaged chariots from the Gulf of Aqaba instead of lugging them overland. Seti built a navy on the Red Sea. Seti I attacked the road to the Philistines and the eastern entrance to the land of Canaan at Beth Shean, thus preparing it for the Hebrews to enter. But they responded to the report of the spies of giants in the land with fear instead of faith, and would not enter Canaan until that generation of the faithless had died. So God again prepared the land of Canaan for the Hebrews to enter by using Ramesses II. The boundaries of Egypt were at their height in the 18th dynasty under Thutmose III. God told Abram that the iniquities of the Amorites had not yet come to the full, but by the time of the Exodus they had. God was going to use the Hebrews to annihilate the Amorites, but since they balked at going in, he used Seti I. In his second year, Seti conquered the Amorites at Kadesh and gave it and the northern lands back to the Hittites for peace. He quashed any rebellion southward and took Syrian, Aramean, and other prisoners back to Egypt as much-needed slaves and quartered them near Heliopolis. Seti defeated a Libyan incursion in the west, and in his eighth year he defeated a Nubian uprising in the south. Thus Seti left his son Ramesses II with a relatively secure kingdom. With his focus and resources in the south and west, the Hittites of the north take the opportunity to incite revolt against Egypt among their neighbors. Ramesses II incorporated Sheridan pirates into his own bodyguard. It is estimated that Ramesses II had an army of 100,000, many of which were mercenaries from other countries, which is reasonable if the former Egyptian army perished in the Red Sea. And in his fifth year, he commenced the infamous Battle of Kadesh. Ramesses II led his army into battle, but his mercenary troops did not follow, and he found himself surrounded by Hittite chariots and courageously fought his way out. Though in Egypt Ramesses engraved it as a victory, Muwatali, the Hittite king, stated he chastened Ramesses. Muwatali took over Syria and continued to press southward, forcing Ramesses again to shore up his strength in Canaan. In Ramesses' eighth year, he besieged the Canaanite cities of Debir, Beth Amuth, and Kunon, as well as Salem, the city of the Jebusites. In Ramesses' 11th year, he lost most of Palestine and barely held on to Ashkelon. In his 21st year at the signing of the treaty with the Hittites, they gave Ramesses II the fortress of Coel, Syria, which lies at the southern end of the Bekaa Valley in Lebanon, as Egypt's northernmost boundary. Ramesses then made a temple to the Hittite god Sutek in Tanis. No Egyptian god temples were made in the land of Kati by King Clitissar. Ramesses II was desperate for slaves to build his many monuments. He was not the pharaoh who had 1 million Hebrew slaves. They left under his grandfather, and this treaty cleared the way for the Hebrews to take Canaan. Joshua 1. From the wilderness and this Lebanon, even to the great river, the river Euphrates, all the land of the Hittites. After the signing of the treaty, the Hittites had clear possession of the lands from Lebanon to the Euphrates, whereas only 50 years earlier, those lands were under Egyptian control and had been for 200 years prior to that. These are my pharaohs of Moses' life in accordance with the biblical chronology. For my Egyptian chronology from Mizraim to Alexander the Great, visit kneelingmedia.org. Your word is true from the beginning, and every one of your righteous judgments endures forever. Psalm 119, 160.